May Day protests by thousands of workers around the country come as the government slashes the number of public servants while accepting a pay rise for MPs. Labor leader Chris Hipkins has defended the sharp increase of public servants on his watch, but also agreed there is room to reduce headcount. So will he be standing in support of May Day protesters? He joins us this morning. Good morning, Mr. Hipkins. Do the protesters have a legitimate argument around the claim that the current government is anti-worker?
Oh, absolutely, and I think we see that regularly from the current government. Even if you look at things like the increase in the minimum wage, which was well below the rate of inflation. So someone on the lowest income, someone earning the minimum wage, is actually seeing their income in real terms, their purchasing power, going backwards under this government. You know, the decisions that they're taking, every day they get choices, and the choices that they're making are not in favour of those who are working hard for a living. They prioritised $2.9 billion worth of tax cuts for landlords, and now cutting, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars in jobs from the public service. They didn't need to do that. They made the choice that tax cuts for landlords was more important to them.
Okay, you make some very valid points there, but you have in the past, even on this program as well, said that there was room to reduce the headcount in the public service. Are those not two positions that are in contrast with each other? You are taking on, to some degree, the government's position of being anti-worker.
No, not at all. And in fact, I think there are examples of where that could happen without the huge disruption that we're seeing. So, for example, some government agencies did receive time-limited funding, or what Nicola Willis calls a fiscal cliff under our government, to do a specific project. So if we take the Ministry for Business, Innovation and Employment, for example, they significantly increased their workforce when they were running things like managed isolation for those who were coming into the country during the COVID period. As we no longer ran managed isolation, those people lost their jobs effectively. Those jobs were disestablished. They were always intended only to be temporary jobs. So across the public service, you'll find examples of where people are employed to do a particular job, that job is done, and therefore that job is disestablished. That happens regularly. We'd been clear that we did expect to see a scale back in coming years as a result of those changes. In many cases, it was because funding for specific things was running out, and therefore they would need to make those adjustments. What this government are doing is going much, much further. They're cutting into frontline services. They're cutting jobs in customs, for example, who are people who work on our frontline border. They're cutting people who work in things like preventing child exploitation and money laundering and online scammers and so on. Those are frontline services that they're cutting into. We had no intention of doing that.
The government will say that these are not frontline workers, though, that these roles are being disestablished from. We have a One News variant poll out this morning, a supplementary question on whether the public support these government job cuts to the scale at which they are being done. What is the sentiment you are hearing, and what do you think the public makes of the size of the cuts?
I would hope that they would be concerned about them because they are cutting into frontline services that will leave New Zealand more at risk. So if you're the victim of an online scammer, then actually the people who work hard to prevent that are frontline, frontline workers. You would view them as frontline workers. If you're working in the farming industry, then actually the people who work on our border in biosecurity, those are frontline workers. They're people who are protecting your livelihood by stopping, incursions into New Zealand of pests and disease that could absolutely cripple your industry and your sector. So those are frontline workers. So I think New Zealanders do see that the government has gone far too far in the changes and in the cuts that it's making.
The May Day protesters say that this is an anti-worker government, but that it's not just the public service cuts. Which of the government's other policies really concerns you?
Well, we've seen the rolling back of fair pay agreements, for example, which were designed to stop the race to the bottom. They were designed to stop, businesses effectively competing with one another by cutting the wages of their staff. Fair pay agreements would have done that. The current government cancelled that almost as soon as they became the government. They haven't increased the minimum wage by a rate that will keep up with the rate of inflation. There are further changes to come. We know that they're going to make changes to employment law, for example, which will dial back the rights of workers at work. So we're already seeing examples of that. And actually, one that's really concerning to me, there's a huge question mark hanging right now over pay equity claims and the government's role in helping to settle pay equity claims. It is simply wrong. I cannot justify to my daughter why she would potentially be paid less than her brother doing exactly the same work. I think government needs to fix the fact that women are paid less than men in the workforce. We had a program of work to do that, and I understand the current government are looking to cut that. These are things are all anti-worker. And, you know, this is a government that don't, they talk a big game, but they don't seem to, in their actions, actually value people who go out and work hard every day.
OK, we are talking cuts, public service cuts, cuts to workers' rights. There is one place, the Beehive, where there is a pay rise coming for MPs. Now, I know you're going to tell me the Remuneration Authority sets that and you respect their independence, but do you personally think now is the time for you to be getting a pay rise?
Well, I didn't ask for one, and you know, so you can you know take my answer from that. It's not something that I was asking for, but I also think that politicians have made a mistake in the past in interfering in the Remuneration Authority's processes. And one of the reasons that the pay increases that we're seeing now are probably larger than they might otherwise have been was that for the last, you know, quite a long period of time, sort of starting I think with John Key not long after he became Prime Minister, politicians have meddled in this process, and so I think we're best to keep out of it. We have to think not just about ourselves, but actually, you know, 10, 15 years down the track, who might sit in the chairs that we sit in now. And I think that the best thing that we can do is to just keep completely out of that process. It's done independently, and that's the way it should be done.
I want to pick up on a point you made there, because I was going to say to you, well, Jacinda Ardern did freeze the pay rise, and should Christopher Luxon do the same? But now I want to ask you if you think she made a mistake in freezing that pay rise.
Yes, I said this yesterday. I think both John Key and Jacinda Ardern governments, and I was part of the Jacinda Ardern government, so I accept some responsibility for this too, tried to sort of make a political problem go away by effectively creating a longer-term problem. I think the best thing that we can do is set the parameters in which the Remuneration Authority operate, which Parliament has done, and then just let them make the decisions independently. And that means we can't complain either way. We can't complain when we think we're hard done by, but we also can't complain when we think that actually it's inconvenient for us to be getting pay increases.
The Prime Minister has said that he will donate his extra to charity. I'm not sure if that's pre or post tax. Will you be donating the extra? And I should probably point out yours is a lot smaller than other MPs, but will you be donating the extra salary that you are about to receive to any charity?
Yeah, I'm already quite a heavy donator to charity. You know, I do believe that those of us who are on higher incomes, and I regard myself as a higher income New Zealander, should actually do the right thing and make sure we're contributing. So I'm a regular contributor to a range of charities, and I'm always, you know, on the lookout for how I can do more to support those around me.
OK, nothing specifically earmarked for this current bump through to 2026 yet, though.
Oh, to be honest, I haven't figured out how much it's going to be yet. So,
but I know it's less than
most.
You're on 296. You're going to get 309.
Right. Thank you.
You're welcome. Spend it wisely. That is Leader of the Opposition, Chris Hipkins, joining us from Wellington this morning.